This is our facility in Scottsdale, Arizona. What we do is diagnosis and management of parasitic organisms, protozoans, worm parasites, and bacterial parasites from various body fluids and body sites. We also work with toxicities related to Morgellons disease, what we like to call neurocutaneous syndrome. We do educational services in the United States and overseas, consultations, and they have over 200 publications on parasitology to our credit. Why would you want to be tested for parasites? It depends on whether you have GI symptoms or systemic symptoms. Many parasites, as a result of the presence of the GI tract, will produce toxins and metabolic byproducts to which your immune system will react to in a typical allergic reaction, and as such, the other systemic infections will appear. Quite often, for instance, Blastocystis hominis will cause abdominal cramps, diarrhea, and constipation, and at the same time will also cause skin abnormalities, nausea, fatigue, and the rest of it. Same parasite. So the parasite effects are double-folded. Directly in the GI tract, as well as systemically outside of the intestinal tract. How do we get infected with parasites? There's four major pathways through which we can acquire infections of parasites: drinking water, skin contact directly, food, arthropod infections, such as Lyme disease, which is a major topic in this conference, air, upper respiratory tract infection, pets. Please remember, dogs, despite what you've been told, are not man's best friend, and cats to a large extent also. So you need to, if you're keeping the pets, you need to observe basic sanitary exposures and contacts with them, especially when there are children involved. And the soil, of course, hookworms and threadworms, as well as many species of GI bacteria, pathogenic bacteria. We have developed a new system for processing fecal samples. The results of our work is always published, and this is a summary of the technique that we have used. And as you can see, we have 50 to 80% more species and individuals of intestinal parasites and fecal specimens that we diagnose than found using other standard tests, which are usually the tests which are available in U.S. public health laboratories, government facilities, as well as in most hospitals. I don't expect you to read every single word here, but this is just a sheet that comes with every fecal kit that a patient receives that gives them direction as to how to properly prepare to collect a proper stool specimen that is amenable to testing by our facility. And this is the rest of the directions. We are very fussy about how we like our samples to be prepared to make sure that it is not compromised. In the diagnostic stool kit that you will receive by mail from our offices in Scottsdale, Arizona, a patient has to fill out this information to provide us, and the bottom part of the same sheet, we get some insight into the patient's exposure, family contacts, as well as symptoms. All these are good tools to zero in more precisely on the diagnosis that we provide. Specimens come in vials as such, and then they are filtered and stained and centrifuged, and you have a concentrated plug at the bottom of the centrifuge tubes, which is eventually put on a slide and examined microscopically. The concentration sedimentation technique that we use is very important in concentrating the parasites, if present, at the fecal plug. This way you have a much higher chance of recovering the infection if it is present. An example of a test result sheet, that's a diagnostic report that the practitioner gets from our office. either by fax or by email, whichever way works for you. Has the patient information here, the practitioner's information, as well as we have here what looks like a shopping list of the different major species of parasites that we recovered. This is a patient that had 2 out of 4. The range, the normal value is 0 parasites. 4 is very heavy infections. So this person had 2 out of 4 blastocystis hominis, and 1 Entamoeba hartmanni, and 1 yeast, and 1 very poor bacteria. Bacteria count should be at least, this is normal good bacteria, should be at least 2 or 3 out of possible 4. 4 out of 4 is an overpopulation, which is also pathogenic, and 1 or less than 1 is also indicative of poor intestinal flora that is not supportive or competitive with possible parasites presence in that person's intestinal tract. Using our technology that I have developed a few years back, we found out that 72% of infected patients in the United States have blastocystis hominis, the most commonly found species, and Cryptosporidium parvum is the second in terms of prevalence, and Entamoeba histolytica, dispar, which is a dual species, is the third in terms of prevalence in the United States. We also found out that roughly 31% of infections of persons are infected with the pathogenic protozoans or subclinical, and the prevalence overall is 22 to 27 in the winter and 36 to 43 in July, October, this seasonality in the United States. But on the average, overall, the prevalence of infection of cross-sectional population in the United States is 32% from our laboratory. U.S. Public Health Laboratory gives you a diagnosis of up to 20-22% max in a very good lab. We are at least 50% higher in positive recovery rate because of our improved techniques, and because also I'm the only one that is allowed to read slides and diagnose specimens. I do not allow anyone else to look at the slides for that particular purpose. So basically what it says is that average U.S. population, 1 out of every 3 people is infected with parasites. There's about 70 of us here today. Maybe that means about of us, whether you know it or not, there's about 20-25 people sitting in this room now have parasites and they don't know it, or perhaps they know it one way or the other. We also do bacteriology testing by swab culture technique, and we find commonly in the intestinal tract E. coli, Klebsiella, Salmonella, Vibrio cholera, Citrobacter, Proteus, Shigella, Campylobacter, Yersinia, and Clostridium difficile. Those species that we commonly find, and the positive species are the ones which are marked in bold letters with the plus in front of them. Our bacteriology test results also provide sensitivity test results as well as resistance test results. Even though we have here 4 categories of possible treatment to which the pathogens that are here are sensitive to, the categories number 1 and number 2 are the most efficacious, which we recommend that be used. But outside of that, allopathic remedies, we recommend even more our herbal remedies, which I'll speak about after lunch today, to be used because they're equally, if not better, more efficacious than allopathic remedies against pathogenic bacteria. The herbal remedy for parasitic infections that we have developed, we have had some publications on them. That's one of them here. And here we collected roughly, I don't know, close to 1,000 herbs. We produced educational videos, which have been used, some of them have been used in some medical colleges in the United States. Common parasite remedies, those of you I'm sure must have come across many of these. Allopathic remedies, albendazole, albendazole is very common for roundworms. And then you have a whole slew of other allopathic remedies. Tenidazole is a good one, praziquantel is good, but they're more or less targeting special organisms. Praziquantel we find is very good for schistosomiasis in Africa, as well as in Central America. Tenadazole is good for blastocystis. Permethrin is okay for skin ectoparasites and some worms. Those are the herbal remedies which are commonly used in the United States. Tricycline by allergy research, biocidin, I believe there is a booth for biocidin here in this conference. Tunnel bits by Dr. Crook. He died, but his product is still alive and well. All of these are targeted to a special narrow range of parasites. And then there's Freedom Cleanse and Restore, which is our product, which is broad spectrum and covers all protozoans, all worms, and all bacteria and fungi. We have very good experimentation and double-blind studies that show it's very efficacious for these, and the information is on our booth right outside the door here. The product includes three formulations: freedom from parasites, cleansing and integrative of the systems, and restoring of damaged tissue back to its normal state after the parasites have been taken care of. The information again is provided outside, and we usually recommend 2 months treatment at full dose and 1 month at half dose for acute cases, 4 months treatment for chronic cases of long standing, and 2 months at half dose for those chronic cases. I have patients in West Africa that take it for up till 8 or 9 months at a time. And they have patients that are on it on a maintenance dose, at half dose, for much longer period of time in cases which are difficult to explain right now. The most common parasite in the United States, Blastocystis hominis, will cause fecal-oral contamination, and will also include skin abnormalities in addition to GI symptoms, as I mentioned earlier. This is a heavy case of Blastocystis hominis. In that case, you have so many organisms in that fecal sample, and as a natural response on the part of the host tissue, the intestinal lining will produce a lot of mucus proportional to how heavy the infection is. We published a paper here that won a very important prize in the tropical medicine literature. The year it was published, 2006, on epidemiology of Blastocystis hominis in the United States. Cryptosporidium parvum is the second most common intestinal parasite in the United States. Roughly about 25% or so of U.S. households that are supplied by water from open water treatment plants, surface water treatment plants, will have Cryptosporidium spores in the tap water. You can drink your water safely at home, quote unquote safely. You can get infection by crypto in your own home. You don't have to be vacationing or drinking stream water or getting contaminated by a food source that is infected or whatever. In your own home. And also, there's also another parasite that's available that can come to you through tap water, which I'm going to come across in a few moments. Our prevalence rate of Cryptosporidium infections in the United States is about 13%. The average reported by public health hospitals and laboratories is 2 to 4% from Europe, and the United States is not much different, but our rate is much higher. We have a much nicer technique. Our paper on Cryptosporidium parvum is also out in our booth. This is the summation of it here. Shows that out of 9,000 fecal specimens examined, 4,928 patients from all states, District of Columbia, 2003 to 2005, you have overall prevalence was lowest in the winter months and peaked in May, especially in males, who are relatively more frequently infected than females. Additional peaks were observed in September and February. frequency of infection increases with age in both sexes, up to age 80 to 89. But our rate in the United States is 13%. Cyclospora catenensis, I know that at least two people in the audience here today have had chronic cyclospora infections and have had difficulty with them. Cyclospora presumably is acquired from foreign sources, especially grapes and fresh fruits from Latin America coming to the United States off season when there's no naturally grown fruits as such are available in the local market. However, we had a study here that shows that Cyclospora catenensis infections are endemically found in the United States, and we do not have to import things from foreign, we don't have to point the finger to other foreign cultures that we import things from to be responsible for our problems in the healthcare system. We found out surface water treatment plants in the United States are more amenable to promote cyclospora infections than other water treatment plants. In the Phoenix area, we have divided Phoenix to different zip codes and found out the zip codes that are supplied by surface water treatment plants compared to areas which are not supplied by surface water treatment plants. We found out a 2 to 3 times higher rate of cyclospora in local Phoenix population in households supplied by the surface water treatment plants than the other neighborhoods supplied that are fall under different zip codes. So we know that this happens despite public health denial of it. I used to work for CDC, and the thing that works for CDC very routinely is the politics. It's a political more than a health institution. And when you don't want the politics, then you don't want to be in. Okay, Entamoeba histolytica and Entamoeba dispar. Those are two species which are morphologically identical. You cannot separate them from each other under the microscope. But histolytica is pathogenic and dispar is not pathogenic. Histolytica will go into the liver, will invade the intestinal wall, but dispar will not do that. This is a cyst and this is a trophozoite of Entamoeba histolytica or dispar. Rate in the United States, 7%. This is a trophozoite actively feeding on a host cell. This is the actual trophozoite here, it's feeding on a white blood cell. And as a byproduct of this feeding process, the white blood cell will burst open and this protoplasm will crystallize, producing this crystal here. It's called Charcot-Leydon crystal, which is a footprint of an Entamoeba presence in that person's intestinal tract. If you don't find the organism, but you find the crystal, you know the organism is there even though you have not seen it. Because Entamoeba histolytica is nasty in that it is cyclic. Some days it will appear in the stool specimen, some days it will not appear. The days where it is not appearing, where it is not running, you see the crystals, you still know it is there and you have to treat for it as if you've seen the actual organism. The organism penetrates the intestinal wall, causing acute inflammatory reaction sites. This is a section in the intestinal wall showing the penetration site of Entamoeba histolytica under the epithelial cell layer. Perianal amoebiasis in this child, the left, and then sometimes you have developed ulcerative amoebic colitis as a result of the buildup of bacteria causing ulcerative and metastasis in infection sites of the amoeba into the intestinal wall, become ulcerative and the patient will die not from an amoeba infection per se, but from the ulcerative colitis, prompting sometimes tests of cancer. This is a patient who died of cancer and was traced to ulcerative colitis. When you have a child with ulcerative colitis, what do you treat him with? Most doctors will give steroids, right? Wrong way to do it. We have actually half the children that we see from the East Coast with ulcerative colitis, when they are examined for parasites and the parasite is found, they are treated for the parasite, the ulcerative colitis disappears. E-histolytica also have a nasty way of penetrating the gut wall with the circulation hepatic portal system going into the liver and anywhere else where the blood goes. This is a trophozoid that infects this person's lungs, brain, and you can see here this patient, actually this is a post-mortem examination of a person that died of a brain dysfunction as a result of amoebic infection. Trophozoid going through a venule, migrating, and this is a liver that is, this person died of hepatomegaly or enlargement of liver as a result of E. histolytica infection, the liver is hemosecret. This is the same patient as this one here, was cut open, and this is the that liver in that patient here. This is the approximate size of the liver in that patient, size of the liver in that patient, which is more than twice the normal size for a child that age. Entamoeba coli is another species of entamoeba that is not invasive, not pathogenic, does not go into the liver, does not circulate with the hepatic portal system, and otherwise it is very similar to Entamoeba histolytica. Giardia lamblia is another species of protozoan that can enter your household with water at a rate of roughly, on the average, 23 to 27% of households that are fed by surface water treatment plants for water source. Coming through your tap water, you can get the spores of Giardia. This is the spores of Giardia to the right here. That's the stage we usually commonly find. The trophozoites are here to the left-hand side, 20%. Balanitidium coli is a parasite of swine, but it does not cause any pathology in the swine, but if it's accidentally ingested by contamination with unsanitary practices on the swine farm, a human being can be extremely susceptible to the debilitating effects of this infection and can suffer pathologically very seriously, while the swine itself is refractive to it. Now, this is something that will pose an interesting taxonomic as well as pathologic dilemma for many practitioners, and that is there's a number of species of protozoans that are declared null and void, declared neutral, declared non-pathogenic, and when they are found in patients, doctors usually do not treat for them. They say, oh, this do not cause any harm or damage. Most of the literature says that. But our literature does not say the same thing. Actually, Endolimax nana, Aedemoeba butchilli, Dantamoeba fragilis, and Chylomastix mesnelli are protozoans that do cause damage, especially for young children and older people. They have GI symptoms, especially diarrhea and sometimes constipation and abdominal cramps. They are not fatal by any stretch of imagination, but they do cause pathology in the intestinal tract. And on the face of it, how can we imagine foreign organisms living in the human body and the body is indifferent to their presence if they feed off of your body fluids? The body is never indifferent to any presence of any foreign organism, no matter how the books describe it. Those guys don't read English, they don't know what's in the books, and they act as they normally would in the presence of a host system that supplies nourishment for them. And here is an example. This is our study, which is actually out at the booth here now, which shows the species of so-called parasites in singly infected patients. Blastocystis hominis is out of 581 singly infected patients, 469% have symptoms, and 31% do not have symptoms. There's many subclinical infections, and the same with the recognizable parasitic species, but those are the supposedly non-pathogenic bacteria. All of them will cause symptoms, which means they all cause pathology. Quite often also, you will come across many different organisms or cellular material in the stool specimen when you examine it that suggests to the non-careful eye that you have other parasites in there, but actually they are not parasitic. White blood cells look very much like amoeba, squamous epithelial cells, columnar epithelial cells in the upper intestinal tract, and red blood cells can be confused with parasites, but they are not. Candida albicans, yeast, alternaria, another kind of fungus, and geotrichum, another kind of fungus, they're not actually parasitic per se. Citrus particles, tomato skin, mucus casts, and bean sprouts look very much like parasites also. The one thing that is most confusing and most disturbing is that there is a website of concerned mothers that go around shooting down every lab, not just my lab, but many other labs in the country, for failure to diagnose Ascaris worms and labeling them as mucus casts. And concerned mothers are not parasitologists. And it is. I don't want to use any more words than this, but this is not an ascaris, it's a mucus cast. The mucus tend to be sometimes eliminated in a cylindrical form that is compatible with the outline of the intestinal lining of the epithelium cells in the intestinal tract, and they can be readily confused for roundworms. But we'll see how roundworm looks like in a few moments. Mushroom spores, pollen grains, plant parasite, heterodira egg, and mite eggs. Mite eggs and mice are floating dust in the air in the room all the time, and we're all exposed to them, and we inevitably will inhale them or we'll swallow them. Antibiotic crystals, fatty acid crystals. We also mark a lot of things that are not parasitic in nature because they are bioindicators to other conditions. For instance, the fatty acid crystals, we usually find them in people that have gallbladder problems because gallbladder is more involved into the fat metabolism and lipid metabolism. And invariably, whenever we find fatty acid crystals in large numbers and we report them, the doctor finds out that the patient has gallbladder problems. antibiotic crystals. We strictly require that the patient be off antibiotics for 2 weeks before collecting a stool specimen for our testing. But then when we see these, we know that the patient lied. So we tell them, your specimen is not good. We refuse to test specimens which are not correctly provided, correctly collected. Potatoes. Trichomonas vaginalis, the major cause of unspecific vaginitis, can sometimes move from the urogenital tract into the anal area because of proximity and liquid involvement in both areas and transmitted via sexual intercourse. Occasionally found in newborn infants by just a mere passage through the tract. And here is a case of vaginitis seen through a vaginal speculum. Typically creamy discharges, often infected with candida albicans, this case here. But that's how the organism looks like. We see it sometimes. Mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. There's three species of leishmaniasis worldwide: Leishmania tropica, Leishmania orientalis, and Leishmania or the Espandia forms in Central and South America. And hence the name mucocutaneous leishmaniasis, because they tend to affect the mucous tracts around the mouth and the nasal area, unusually in some drier sites, but usually in those areas here. Those cases are beyond even surgical correction, and they sometimes are secondarily infected with bacteria, and the patients suffer from just simply not being able to eat properly because they can't get the food through this debilitated oral cavity. I don't know how many of you are aware of Trypanosoma cruzi or Chagas disease. We found out that Chagas disease, especially in the Amazon in Brazil, is more common than you like it to be. The main reservoir are opossums and raccoons and medium-sized mammals. The main vector is assassin bugs, sometimes called kissing bugs, because they tend to bite around the mouth, around the face. They're usually found in the huts at the edge of the forested areas. They hang around the inside walls of this wood makeshift living spaces, and they come out at night and they bite. Those bugs are big. They're about 1 inch in size, so you cannot miss them. But somehow they figure out a way to bite without causing any pain at the bite site, so you don't feel it biting. So the patient is sleeping and the bite takes place, and then the process, the pathogen is a blood parasite that lives outside in the plasma. It lives outside the blood cells, and the main symptoms are periorbital edema and the heart is congested. Is about twice the size, and when the heart is cut open in post-mortem examinations, you find that the heart is mostly fibrotic tissue because there's a total loss of muscle tone in the heart from the parasite. You also have a phenomenon called megacolon. The colon becomes enlarged, but doubles the size as a result of the feeding the parasite in the nerve elements around the colon, so it allows it to enlarge and not contain itself with the proper peristaltic consistency. Many people in Brazil rainforest die from heart disease, not because of pressure on the job or fighting at home or whatever. It is because of T. cruzi infections. Toxoplasma gondii, toxoplasmosis, is more or less common in the United States, but mostly in the northern rather than the southern states, because in the northern states, the cat is the main reservoir system, and the cats, because on account of the cold season, the cold weather, the cat stays indoors more often than outdoors, and the spores are more readily breathed in. If you have a cat at home, make sure it goes in and out, and the cat litter needs to be changed at least twice to three times a week, so that the spores do not accumulate and become accidentally inhaled as you clean the litter and you feed and do whatever it is that people do with cats and dogs. I'm much more at ease with camels and elephants. A case of cerebral state of, this is a child that was born. Contrary to German measles, where you say the first trimester of pregnancy is the one that is more sensitive to transmission of measles. In the case of toxoplasma, it is the last trimester of pregnancy that is more conducive to transmission of toxoplasma infections in humans. Ascaris lambricoides, that's how Ascaris looks like. It's not like the mucus cast that we've seen once before. Ascaris infection can be acquired and is acquired by the accidental contamination of the eggs of the Ascaris from unwashed or poorly washed vegetables, which are used as salad vegetables, and the egg is ingested accidentally when the salad vegetables are not washed properly. In Arizona, where I live, and adjacent states to Mexico, Half the lettuce that we eat comes from Mexico, and Mexico, I love Mexico as a country and as people, but some practices in the agriculture allow the usage of human waste, which is conducive to transmission of infection in the egg stage, and then you get the lettuce at home. If you don't wash it properly, then you ingest the egg, and the egg will migrate from your intestinal tract, develop, hatch into an L2 larva, goes through the intestinal tract and migrate to the heart, and from the heart to the lung, and the lung had developed further pre-adult stage and re-swallowed again. So all those organs of migration of the worm by the time you have the adult stage in the gut are subject to damage. A person can have poor respiratory situation, respiratory insufficiency, diaphragm can be pierced and compromised, and the heart can have various kinds of heart conditions as a result of the movement of this parasite into your system until the adult reinfects the intestinal tract again. These are the eggs of the worm. Here's the L2 larva ready to hatch out. In this adult case, we gave this kid mineral oil. We starved him for 2 or 3 days, no food, nothing, and then mineral oil, big, huge dose of mineral oil, 2-3 times a day. And then that's what we ended up with here. Very heavy case of infection. Other case, most of these are post-mortem specimens. These are stages of larva vascaris in the lungs. Sometimes they migrate from the intestinal tract to the bile ducts to the liver. See, the bile duct is blocked here. And here is a peritonitis, case of peritonitis, as a result of penetration of the gut and ending up in the body cavity. In this case, the patient died of peritonitis infection. And then here is an example of how the gut itself can be blocked. You can almost see the outline of the gut around this cluster of the nematode, and the food doesn't move through, and the toxemia condition develops, and that's what kills the patient. Anisakis, we had a patient in California that we recovered this particular worm from. It came out from his esophagus through his neck, and we just picked it up from here. The patient eventually died, and this was a study of that one unique case of anisakis from California. It's usually in Hokkaido in Japan, where and the second most prevalent area of sushi and sashimi infection, including anisakis, is in Amsterdam in Holland. So Japan, Holland, and then the United States, third in the same order. Hookworm infection. The hookworm is about maybe 1/4 inch long. It's not a very long worm, but when present in large numbers, you can see the hooks on the hookworm here are pointed, and they tear into the intestinal lining and they suck blood. They are aerobic. They are not anaerobic, even though they are in the gut. So they need oxygen. They get the oxygen only from the blood. So their only way of breathing, of respiration, is to draw as much blood and pick the oxygen from the blood of the patient. They are a continuous, like a faucet that you left open. They cause serious anemia and bloating of the abdominal area as a result of their feeding. The South American form is called Nicator americanus, has one large lip here that is very sharp. It cuts big chunks of the intestinal lining, but this is the human worm, and Ancylostoma duodenale has 3 pairs of teeth which are pointed as such. You get infected by hookworms when you walk barefoot in an area which had been soiled by someone else's defecation. And then unknowingly you will walk into this area, and then the immature stages, L2 and L3 larvae, enter through the skin of the foot, the skin of any part of your body which becomes exposed. We had a case of a woman that was laying on the beach in an area that was soiled and entered through her body, through her thighs. That's whichever part of the body is exposed. But normally it's the foot, under normal conditions it's the foot. Strongyloides tenicularis is a very curious worm because it has a switch in its metabolic pathways that allows her to have a free living lifestyle and then a parasitic lifestyle. When it runs out of hosts to infect, it goes in the ground and feeds on organic matter and metabolizes organic food from the soil for generation upon generation, and until a person or an animal passes by, then they turn the other switch on and they become pathogenic and parasitic. Very, very unique form. Trichinella spiralis, cause of trichinosis. The cycle involves swine and rodents on a swine farm. In the human body, they have the L3 larva that's encysted in the muscle of the eye predominantly, and the muscle at the tips of the finger is called subingual splinter. That's how you can diagnose the case when the patient is alive. Otherwise, you'll find it in the postmortem, mostly in the diaphragm, causing respiratory insufficiencies, and the patient will die from respiratory problems, and you don't know why. But when you cut the patient open, you'll find the diaphragm studded with these worms. U.S. Department of Agriculture does not inspect meat for trichinosis. So you're taking your chances by buying swine meat or ham that is not cooked or that is very pink in appearance. You're taking your chances. Entrobius vermicularis is the cause of pinworm infections in children, older people, the two most likely target groups. The worm is on the left, and those are the eggs. And here is a perianal presence. The worms tend to migrate at night towards the anal opening, and that's when you can collect them. Different ways of, we have a kit that collects pinworms also. So when the mother takes that child that she suspects he has a pinworm infection to the doctor in the morning, she showers him and cleans him up and all this good stuff. And by the morning, of course, the worms are not out in the anal orifice anymore. And the kid is clean, so the kid is examined, and this is, of course, it's negative. So we send the kid to the family, and we ask the mother in particular to use the kit at the child at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning when they're out there. This is the worm, Entrobius vermicularis, necrotic mass on the upper right. And this is one of the old primitive ways of putting a scotch tape to swab the anal orifice, but we have a much nicer method than that now. Trichurus trichura is called the whip worm because the worm looks very unique. The anterior end is the thin end, it's a long round worm, and the posterior end is the thick end. Here is a patient that died from whip worm infection. You can see all the hemolytic reaction on the intestinal lining. This is the large intestine. You can see all the white stuff here is just worms, posterior end of worms. It causes damage to the intestinal nerve system to a point that the nerve, the gut prolapses out of the anal opening, such as in that case here. And this is the egg, which is the diagnostic stage from a normal fecal stool specimen that is examined in the laboratories like ours. Diphyllobacterium latum is a very unique worm. It is as long, can get to be as long as 30 feet long, 10 yards. There's many species comparable to it that are in Europe also, but in the United States, this Diphyllobacterium latum is the common species. This is the anterior end of the worm. This folds here fits within the topography of the intestinal lining. This is the stage that's diagnostic, which is the egg stage. And this is just one worm stripped, lined up this way, so you can get some idea about the size of that worm. Usually a human being can only take one worm infection at a time. The worm has a predilection to deplete the host of vitamin B12, affecting the neurological sensation and the remembrance and memory. And as a result, the patient becomes very forgetful and very weak. And the best way to restore B12 is to get the worm out if the patient is sent to a parasitologist and not to a neurologist, which is the thing here. Because a lot of our practitioners do not think parasitology. Two other common species of worms, Tinea solium is to the left, and Tinea cigenata, which is in the beef, is to the right. You can get infected by, for the most part, by feeding on infected meat that has the eggs or the immature stage of the parasites. There's some dishes which are cooked. I was once recently in a Lithuanian dinner, wedding, and they had this nice big like ground beef dish, which is raw beef with a lot of greens and stuff on top, and that's what they eat. It was a fancy looking dish. Of course, I could not come near it, but that is a very common, that would be a very likely source of infection with Tinea saginatus, which is this one to the right here. They can be long, they can be as long as maybe 10 feet the longest, but not anywhere as long as the Diphyllobacterium latum, the one that we saw before. Tinea solium infections, the immature stages, tend to produce cysts and daughter cysts and daughter cysts of the daughter cysts. Well, you have a number of generations of cysts of Tinea solium in the choice organ in which they are present. And here are some cysts of larva, in this case, in the brain. Here, brain tissue. In the eye, here, and in the muscle. This is a thigh muscle. When that is dissected, that's what you get out of it here. Echinococcus granulosis is common in areas that have sheep herding industries, mostly in Spain and Iberia, as well as in California and the West Coast, where sheep industry is there, because the sheep is the main reservoir, as well as the dog. As you can see, when you butcher a sheep and you throw the viscera away, the dog will feed on the viscera. Okay? And the immature stages, which are in the body cavity of the sheep, which is thrown out, develop to adulthood in the intestinal tract of the dog. Echinococcus granulosis, presence in the, I believe this is the liver of a person or someplace, lower left. This is the liver section here, and this is a scan. If you allow me, I will just go through the slides quickly. Can you take this down in just 1 minute? Thank you.